You'll be amazed at how much money you could save by refilling these aerosol cans at home. In today's short video, I'm going to talk you through the process and what's involved and just how easy it is to do. Firstly, you're going to need a schrader valve, and you can buy these from your local automotive, hardware or bicycle shop. And if you've got an inner tube lying around, you can just cut one off that. There are a couple of locations that you can put these valves, and I've done them both at the top and the bottom of the can. I generally though recommend against the bottom of the can, because of course that valve is sitting in that fluid and it's going to wear it out quicker. And also, if the valve fails, up the top it's only going to leak air. At the bottom, you're going to start to lose the fluid itself. And then we want to remove any of the propellant or the compressed air that's inside this can. And you can simply just do that by exhausting it from the nozzle at the top. Next, we're going to remove that schrader valve. And you can either do this with the correct tool. You can actually buy a schrader valve removal tool. Or if you've got needle nose pliers, you can just simply twist it out with those as well. They're not torqued down very hard, and they'll be easy for you to remove that way. We want to remove all of the rubber that's on the valve stem. In this case, I'm just using a utility knife to get rid of the excess amount. And then we're going to move on to the wire wheel and get that valve as clean as we possibly can. Any amounts of rubber that are left on there, or oil or dirt, is going to affect how it adheres to the can, and you may find that you'll end up with it leaking. Now we're going to measure the valve stem itself. In this case, it was 5.7 millimeters. Now, I don't have a 5.7 mil drill bit, but going a little bit tighter allows a really nice snug fit between the stem and the can. So I dropped down to 5.5. Next, we're going to grab ourselves a little wire brush, wire wheel, or even some sandpaper. And we're just going to clean some of the coating that's on the can, because again, this will stop, in this case, the solder that I'm going to use from adhering. Proper preparation with soldering is so important to get a great result, and it's worth taking that little bit of extra care in every step of this process to get the result that you're after. Then grab yourself the center punch, make a little divot in the middle of that area you've just cleaned, and then you can drill through with your drill bit. You'll probably find that the drill hole is going to be quite rough afterwards, and if you've got a step drill, you can just go in there by hand and just ream and clean that hole out. And now flush the can out a number of times with just some cold water. You want to make sure you've removed all the propellant and all of the chemical that was in the can to avoid a fire when we come to solder it next. And once again, just clean the stem of the valve with a bit of acetone, a bit of brake cleaner, the same with the neck of the can, and then go over that with some flux. Flux both parts, flux the solder and clean that as well. In this case, I'm using a flux pen. It doesn't really matter what you use. The flux just helps the solder to flow. I'm going to use an ice cube, but I've actually drilled a pilot hole and then reamed out the surface, and I'm slipping it over the top of the can just to keep that area cold. And now that everything's nice and clean, it's been fluxed, push the stem into the can and then use some propane or map gas, whatever you've got. Every few seconds, move the heat away and just press that solder between the valve stem and the can itself. And eventually it will melt and it will absorb in. You don't want to heat the solder because you're going to get a cold joint. And now in this case, because it's always going to be on show, I've just got a bit of Scotch-Brite and I'm going to clean up any of that burnt area around the nozzle or valve. And now I'm just going to fill this back up with a bit of water, pop the schrader valve back in place again, and then I'm going to put very low pressure in, just a few PSI. Get a bit of soapy water and spray around the schrader valve and just make sure you're not getting any leaks anywhere. In this case, everything's holding really nice and tight. And now you can just spray out all that water. You can add a little bit more air if you need to, if there's not enough in there. And then you're ready to fill up this can with whatever fluid you like. By replacing brake fluid, in this case with methylated spirits — brake fluid is just mostly alcohol, methylated spirits is just alcohol — by replacing that, I can get a refilled can for $2 rather than 10. That means that every one can that I buy from the shop, I can get 5 cans if I do it myself. My favorite method for filling these cans is to use a Coca-Cola bottle that I've drilled a hole in the end and put some small Tygon tubing in. Make sure that the Tygon can go right through that valve stem. If you just have it pressed up against it, you're going to lose a lot of liquid because you're building up pressure inside. You can squeeze the nozzle to ease that if that's the case, but you may also find that you're just going to be doing this loop of shooting out brake cleaner as you put it in. Always stick with the amount of fluid that's suggested on the can. So in this case, it's a 400 mil can, so I'm going to put 400 mils in. And then just screw that schrader valve back in. It just needs to be finger tight. Don't reef on it because you will damage that valve. And then we're going to add just a little bit of pressure. The more pressure you add, the more the chemical is going to be atomized. I recommend just a few PSI to start with. It's always better to be able to add a little bit of air periodically rather than over pressurizing these cans and then having something go wrong. See how it squirts out the end of the can? You can always add more in now or periodically if you find that pressure drops down. Much better to start very, very low, 2 or 3 PSI, 5 PSI, and then go from there, progressively increase that pressure. It's understandable if you don't feel comfortable with drilling holes and pressurizing cans. There is an alternative. You can actually buy this same principle on Amazon, which is a can that you can refill. However, it does recommend against using harsh chemicals. It really is that easy. And of course, you can put whatever fluids you want inside these, not just brake cleaner. You can make a carb cleaner. You can use a degreaser. You can put oils and lubricants in there as well. And you may have noticed that I'm not giving any specific PSI in which to work to. And for the simple fact that I can't. These cans have been modified. They no longer structurally sound like they were from the factory, and therefore, of course, you have to be really, really careful. And if you've enjoyed today's video, I've got this one up here, which covers my diagnostic process for 2-stroke and 4-stroke engines, and I hope it helps you out when servicing and repairing yours at home.